So I also prepared a small introduction of myself, but I think Andrea did already a very good work. So I will continue with the following slide. So I would like today to present basically two case studies, and in particular the in-plane performance of two typical buildings under induced earthquake in the Groningen province. And in order to do that, I have divided the presentation in four different steps. The first step is basically introducing a little bit the problem. So the induced earthquake due to the gas extraction. The following point is a small introduction about the national code. Of course, the presentation is very tight, so there will not be too much time. And then two basically typical buildings, one terrace house and one detached house. So first of all, for who is not aware, so in the Netherlands and in particular in the Groningen region, there is the biggest gas field in Europe. It was discovered in 1959 and the gas extraction started in 1963. So the gas field is operated by NAM, which is a joint venture between Shell and ExxonMobil. And basically, since 1980, have been recorded thousands of earthquakes until basically the strongest, which was in 2012, with a magnitude of 3.6. From that point, basically, a lot of studies started. And basically, the gas extraction was reduced from 2014. And basically, step by step, we are arriving to today. So the latest news is that the gas field is going to be closed in 2022. So a small note is basically as a gas field is basically first a resource and then step by step a problem. So a small introduction about the in-plane backbones and mechanism and equations included in the national seismic code. So the first one is the flexural behavior. So the equation is not very dissimilar to the one included also in the Eurocode. The interesting part maybe is the equation about the drift. The equation was developed by the Technical University of Delft in the Netherlands with real experiments. And maybe so you can get sometimes even 2% in plane drift for in plane flexural mechanism. The shape of the backbone is very similar to the Eurocode, to the generally used one in Italy or Eurocode. A little bit difference in the shear behavior, so the bed joint sliding, the peak value you can see from the backbone is derived from the generally known equations, and then there is a post-peak behavior which is only the frictional part of the equation. Also, an interesting note for this mechanism is the in-plane drift is set for near collapse, because everything here is set for near collapse, for 0.75% of the effective height. Maybe another important thing, I think, is the is when to stop the analysis. Generally, a 20% of decay is used. In the Netherlands, in the national code, 50% of the decay, so meaning a reduction of the base shear of half. And this is to basically define the final pushover curve. So a little bit of insight, because I think it's interesting comparing with what is commonly done in the Eurocode, is about the calculation of the demand. So in the Eurocode, as you know, but also in Italy, we generally use the N2 method. Instead, in the Netherlands, it's normal practice to use capacity spectrum method. The capacity spectrum method is basically a method in which the elastic response spectrum should be reduced accounting for an extra dumping. The dumping, the final dumping, is basically a sum of the inherent dumping, the common 5%, and the hysteretic dumping, which is calculated and suggested by the MPR by the equations, and generally, and it cannot be actually bigger than 15%. So one note is that generally all the buildings have 20% decay. Sorry, 20% dumping. So acceptance criteria. So basically, it is an intersection. So the building can be considered passing, let's say, the check if the bilinear, which is derived, of course, from the capacity curve, can intersect the overdumped response spectrum. So let's move quickly to the examples. So who is attending the meeting from the Netherlands will see that this is a very common building in the Netherlands and also in the Groningen province. So this is a terrace house. Terrace house is basically a composition, so a block with more units. It is characterized mainly by large openings in the longitudinal direction in the front and back facade. So we have a very weak direction, the longitudinal, and a very strong direction, which is the transversal. So the load-bearing part is usually the transversal walls. So in this case, you can see there are concrete floors, but you can easily find a version of this building with timber floors. The floors are spanning generally from transversal wall to transversal wall. So another peculiarity of this building is the presence of cavity walls in the perimetral walls, so all around. The reason is, of course, for insulation purpose. The inner leaf usually, not always, but usually is composed by calcium silicate bricks with a thickness of 100 millimeters. Of course, there is a cavity gap with a variable measure, it depends. And then another leaf composed by clay bricks. So the structural part, the load-bearing part, is the internal one, so the inner leaf. So for this reason, generally, the outer leaf is not considered in the analysis because the flexibility of the wall ties, which are these elements connecting inner and outer leaf, is considered, so these elements are considered so flexible that cannot actually engage the outer leaf for the in-plane response. In terms of other walls, so there are some internal walls, 100 millimeters, so very slender. Again, in this case, but not, is not always the same, party wall, so the wall dividing two units, is composed by 210 millimeter walls. So what else? So ground floor is a PS insulated ground floor, but generally is always a precast floor. The analysis, generally, we start the analysis from foundation level. Ground floor is not considered. Maybe I didn't mention this. I think an important point to mention is the floor. So in this case, this is a cast in situ floor. And you can see from this detail that the floor is in between the walls. And in this case, it is assumed that can develop a full rigid diaphragm, basically, because the floor is rigid by itself, but also the connection are completely rigid. I didn't mention the roof. I added a few pictures in the previous slide. The roof is generally timber, and so it is excluded by the analysis. So it is considered as a mass, but not so the well-known non-structural roof of Trimuri. here is just an example on how to go from 3D model to Trimuri model to Trimuri analytical model, in which, as we just said, there is no roof. Response spectrum can be easily be downloaded from a web tool per street. So some results for this particular binding. So the longitudinal direction is governed by flexure because the piers are very, very slender and few of them due to the openings. The capacity is quite large. The spectrum is there is a damping of 20% creating an intersection, so the check is okay, so the building is okay, so this is the worst combination in X. An interesting aspect of the MPR is that you can account for P delta effects, so basically when you have not too many peers, you can derive a factor in by which you can reduce the capacity or increase the demand, depending. In this case, we reduce the capacity. Completely opposite behavior in the Y direction, basically the strong direction in which the building is reacting mainly in shear due to the squat walls. As we said at the beginning, this is the strong direction, and you can see by the intersection, so the intersection with the elastic spectrum is happening at the elastic range, and also in this direction basically there are no issues. This is the summary of the 24 combinations. They are all fine, basically. Another interesting aspect to mention is the possibility to take into consideration torsional effects, so meaning reducing the capacity or increasing the demands with a factor to take into consideration the torsional flexibility of the building. And this can be done according to the MPR with a model response analysis. As well known, pushover is not enough to provide basically or to have an idea about deficiencies and possibly retrofit measure required for a masonry building. So usually when doing this kind of assessment, we do always a model response analysis to check the roof and the timber components, and also, as I said, to calculate the torsional factor, check the existing condition for boundary condition, nonlinear kinematic for out of plane response, check of non-structural element, and check of foundations. The second building, the second typology I would like to present is the so-called detached house, in which basically they are isolated buildings, mainly one floor. So they present also a different, but still, timber roof. Sometimes the roof can be very, very complex. There is no weak and strong direction clearly, so it depends by the configuration of the internal walls. Also for these buildings, we can have cavity walls or solid 100 walls or solid 210 millimeter walls, but always quite slender walls. A challenge of these buildings to model in Trimuri is that sometimes the walls, some of the walls are basically below the level of the ground, of the first floor. So usually we fixed a floor level and then we play with individual walls in order to match the effective height of the pier, since the final capacity of the buildings will be derived from the effective height. Same as the previous building, we don't model the roof structure. Another peculiarity of these buildings is very often they have timber floor, so flexible floor. So it means that comparing with the previous building in which a global analysis is correct and possible, for this type of buildings, since redistribution is not guaranteed by the flexible floor, we prefer an assessment wall by wall, in which basically redistribution is not taken into account at all. So again, this is shown now to go from a 3D model to a Trimuri model to a Trimuri analytical model in which we don't have the roof. Response spectrum follow the same as before. Results in this case are presented wall by wall, as we said. This is again one of the worst combination in X direction in which the outcome is positive. Same for a wall in Y direction. And if we want to have a summary here, of course, the combination or more, but they are not the combination, it's just that is a wall by wall assessment. As you can see also here, basically all the walls are fine. So again, I will not repeat, but basically in order to have an idea about the building, also a number of other analysis and assessment and checks need to be done. So finally, some conclusions to wrap up. So along the years, specific advanced studies and analysis were carried out in order to adapt the approach from Eurocode and New Zealand code to the Dutch buildings for the in-plane assessment. Several tests and research programs were carried out along the years to improve and remove conservatism from the Dutch seismic code. The substantial reduction of gas extraction in the region during the years led to a decrease of the seismic hazard in prevision. And as a result, despite the vulnerability of the buildings and the walls that I highlighted somehow, there is generally no need for retrofit for the in-plane behavior in the vast majority of the cases, basically. So that's it. I would like to give a special thanks to the reseller of Trimuri in the Netherlands, Technosoft, and also to Stadata to have invited me. Thank you.